In Cornell's West book, Race and Architecture, West, a philosopher and cultural critic, points out that architecture went through a phase of trivialization of the profession, where it experienced a failure of vision. He argues that since architecture is influenced by both what he calls rigorous discipline and poetic building, which can roughly be translated into science and art, it has an obligation to stay current and ever-changing. Architecture is influential and catalytic, but deeply affected by historical precedent. West goes on to say that the crisis previously defined is rooted in the myth of the machine. This myth, or rather a social and cultural phenomenon, promotes the five P's, which are power, productivity for profit, political control, and publicity. The answer to this architectural crisis, West hypothesizes, is to find new forms and proportions and untapped resources, such as minorities and women. He states that even Le Corbusier was inspired by Louis Armstrong's Hot Jazz, seeing it in mathematics equilibrium on a tightrope, as well as virtues of a machine. We agree that the only way to widen our horizons in the field of architecture is to move beyond the previous exclusivity of the field and search for new inspiration from the unknown. We see this change, though, happening before our eyes, even in our school, where students come from all around the world and are from different ethnicities and backgrounds.
Subsequently, author Laurie Brown argues inclusivity in her work Feminist Practices. Brown starts out by pointing out some drastic statistics. Mostly, the ratio of male to female first-year architecture students is 50%, but by the fifth year, there are less than 17% female students remaining. She says that the field of architecture is not diverse enough, and that women are robbed out of opportunities. A famous example of such exclusion would be Denise Scott Brown, who, along with Robert Venturi, was a prominent theorist and designer. Her work, however, was not honored, and she was disregarded for the Pritzker Prize that her partner received. It wasn't until 2004 that a woman, Zaha Hadid, received this top award. As a solution to this marginalization, Brown proposes the notion of feminist practices. She defines these as feminist methodologies in their research and design, and create works to explore personally and regionally relevant problems pertaining to their environment. Urban Threads is an example project that includes feminist practices in communities. The installation explored ways in which those without land, money, and power shape the urban fabric. They portrayed scenes of women's personal experiences in windows of Melbourne's urban fabric. An example of feminist practices in design is Breathing Spaces by Cynthia Hammond. Hammond challenges the understanding of a building's airflow by changing ventilation and sound systems. Architectural historian Anne Marie Adams discussed that women have long been associated with the health of interior domestic spaces. A healthy house was an equally important expression of women's participation in public urban realm, and was even suggested to be an expression of female power.
The field of architecture needs to be more diverse.
All this brings about a different form of architecture. In Special Agency, Jeremy Till and other authors critique the working title book, Alternative Architectural Practice. The problem with alternative is that it has many interpretations and is defined by the norm, possibilities rather than alterity. The problem with architectural is that it excludes some aspects of the world, and it suggests that architects are the only ones involved in the creative production of the built environment. The problem with practice is the instrumental demands and the clients in the market determine it. Special expands radically architecture as a term. The production is a shared enterprise and the social space is dynamic. Agency is the ability of the individual to act independently of the constrained structures of society. Agents act as a part of mutual enterprise, abandoning the hierarchies embedded in most professional relationships and accepting contributions from everyone. Consequences of architecture are of much more significant than the objects of architecture.
An example of a project that considers the world around it is the Masoro Village project in Rwanda. Here, a group called the GA Collaborative designed, and helped build a house for the local women's group. The GA Collaborative is a group of architects that believes that all have the right to good design. One of the founders is Yutaka Sho, an assistant professor at Syracuse. They try to help and build communities through research, design, and education. In the Masuro Village Project, the collaborative was challenged to design a house that was both affordable and used local materials in its construction. The house uses bags of soil from the site instead of traditional brick or clay. It was also built by volunteers and members of the local community. In Rwanda, where public debate is discouraged, the Masuro Village House allows the community to come together and collaborate. It also empowered the workers by giving them the skills and knowledge to build a house. It is ironic, however, that in Rwanda, building a house that encompasses a traditional African way of life is often seen as a polite name for poverty. There, many of the locals reject traditional Rwandan practices to embrace Western ideals. We believe that the Masuro Village and similar projects may help this problem by establishing a stronger local identity.
Finally, in her article Critical Practice, Sarah Wigglesworth presents an argument for Architecture to Act. Wigglesworth puts forth five assertions about how architectural practice can be critical. 1. The capacity of architecture to be critical depends on its context. 2. There are three main arenas in which to develop a critical practice of architecture: formally or aesthetically, programmatically, and professionally. 3. There is no causal route from critical thinking to critical architecture. 4. You may not immediately recognize a piece of critical architecture. And 5. To practice critically implies acting politically. Wigglesworth goes on to describe her project Desiring Practices, an exhibition where she addressed gender issues as they pertain to the field of architecture. Although the project was widely misunderstood, she tries to evoke a discussion to examine this gender issue from within architecture. Wigglesworth also argues that for men, a house is a place of leisure, while traditionally, for women, it's a place of work. She points out that work and leisure are not always separated and indistinguishable. In her Stock Orchard Street home, she takes things quite literally and separates the living space from the workspace by their exterior facades. The office's facade is meant to look upholstered and also uses cement bags to resemble furniture associated with leisure and the home, while the home itself uses aluminum siding which she associates with business and work. The bedroom's walls are also constructed of straw bales, while the upholstered exterior of the office is actually made of quilted fabric that is meant to be replaced after a while with another material. In another one of her works, A Place for Eating, Wigglesworth makes an installation entirely out of wheat products in a move she calls commercial suicide. While we do agree with Wigglesworth's five assertions, we feel that her work often seems to be silly and fails at being catalytic and critical.
Architecture is entering a new age, where design brings about change and is both socially and culturally inclusive.